Have you ever wondered how many ways we have to bring home information about the universe? One may think about probes, orbiting satellites, rovers, and all the techniques we have learned to master over time. All the data we collected helped us to put the scattered pieces together. In fact, when we try to understand our universe, we are actually just trying to solve a giant puzzle. But what if I told you that the universe itself is trying to communicate with us, giving us some tips on how to understand more about it? What if I told you that it is sending us DMs all the time? And I mean a lot of them. Billions of them every second reach the Earth. These messages are called cosmic rays. And when we first demonstrated their existence, we were on a flying balloon. It was 1912. Since then, they never quit to amaze scientists all over the world. But what are they? Where do they come from? Which information do they carry with them? Follow me on this journey to know the answer to all these questions and to fall in love with cosmic rays. I promise you won't be able to resist them. Let's be clear. Cosmic rays are not actually rays. They're a form of radiation. Although they're called so, they consist of high-energy emitted particles. These particles are raining down on us from space. They are little bits of atoms whizzing by us, even through us, all the time. In this exact moment, you are having a shower of them. Did you bring your shower gel? They are hitting us, but they aren't causing our bodies any harm, so you don't have to worry too much about them. But sometimes they can, for example, cause malfunction to our computers, so you can blame them for making your computer crash. Particles that are hitting us are actually called secondary cosmic rays, because they are a secondary product of swarms of primary cosmic rays created in the atmosphere, with interaction that typically produce a cascade of secondary particles starting from a single energetic particle. One thing we certainly do know about cosmic rays is that they are comprised of extremely energetic charged particles like protons, alpha particles, and atomic nuclei like helium and iron, with minuscule proportions of antiparticles thrown into the mix. It's hard to imagine just how shocking the discovery of cosmic rays must have been to physicists in the early 1900s. The energy of these particles were monumental in comparison to those of every other particle they had observed until that point. For example, the average energy of a solar photon is approximately 1.4 electron volts EV. For reference, a flying mosquito has an energy of about 1 trillion EV, or 1 times 1012 EV. But a mosquito is also much, much larger than a single particle. Meanwhile, an alpha particle emitted during the decay of uranium-238 possesses 4.27 times 10 to the power of 6 EV of energy. Compare that to a cosmic ray proton, which has an energy of some 1 times 10 to the power of 20 EV. That means a proton can only reach that extreme macroscopic energy by traveling at almost the speed of light. Try to think about the famous Einstein equation. Of the nuclei, about 90% are simple protons, 9% are alpha particles, and 1% are the nuclei of heavier elements. A very small fraction are stable particles of antimatter, such as positrons or antiprotons. The precise nature of this remaining fraction is an area of active research. But where do cosmic rays come from? Before finding out the answer to this question, be sure to like or dislike the video so that we can continue to improve and make these videos better for you, the viewer. Plus, be sure to subscribe to the channel, clicking the bell so that you don't miss any of our weekly videos. We know that they come from somewhere in space. In 1911 and 1912, Austrian physicist Victor Hess made a series of ascents in a balloon to take measurements of radiation in the atmosphere. He was looking for the source of an ionizing radiation that registered on an electroscope. At that day, scientists used to think that the radiation came from the rocks of the Earth. Victor Hess's balloon flights took such measurements further. In 1911, his balloon reached an altitude of around 1,100 meters. But Hess found no essential change in the amount of radiation compared with ground level. Then, on April 7, 1912, Hess made an ascent to 5,300 meters during a near-total eclipse of the Sun. Since ionization of the atmosphere did not decrease during the eclipse, he reasoned that the source of the radiation could not be the Sun. It had to be coming from further out in space. High in the atmosphere, Hess had discovered a natural source of high-energy particles, cosmic rays. This was an amazing result. Hess shared the 1936 Nobel Prize in Physics for his discovery, and cosmic rays have proved useful in physics experiments, including several CERN, since. But despite being discovered more than a century ago, physicists still don't know where cosmic rays exactly come from. This is because particles are actually deflected by electromagnetic fields. In space, we have some electromagnetic fields randomly oriented, so that it is very hard to understand where in the universe the cosmic ray originated. The short answer to why we can't trace cosmic rays back to their source, magnetic fields, Julia Tjus, professor at the School of Physics and Astronomy at Ruhr University in Bochum, Germany, said. She explains that charged cosmic ray particles are redirected by the magnetic fields they pass through on their long journey through space. As magnetic fields in space have local, small, random-oriented structures, a prediction of the exact path of a cosmic ray particle is impossible, she says. This doesn't mean that we are completely in the dark about these tiny space bullets, though. In 2017, scientists found out that they come from extragalactic zones. The researchers found an overabundance of cosmic rays arriving from one specific region in the sky, located about 120 degrees away from our galactic center, in a direction that falls outside the Milky Way's disk and cannot be associated with any possible sources within the galaxy. The researchers concluded that high-energy cosmic rays must have extragalactic origins. Fortunately, the more energy a cosmic ray has, the less it is deflected by a magnetic field. So by studying ultra-high-energy cosmic rays, researchers should be able to constrain the location of the source even further. And by ultimately discovering the source of high-energy cosmic rays, astronomers hope to learn both where exactly they come from and how they are generated with such great energies. Nowadays, putting all the pieces together, we know that cosmic rays can be divided into two types: galactic cosmic rays, GCR, and extragalactic cosmic rays, that are high-energy particles originating outside the solar system, and solar energetic particles, high-energy particles, predominantly protons, emitted by the Sun, primarily in solar eruptions. But how can we detect and study cosmic rays? While the detection of cosmic rays has been associated with balloon flights ever since, the upper atmosphere isn't the most convenient laboratory to investigate the high-energy particle collisions they produce. To study the collisions caused by cosmic rays, particle physicists retreated below ground, employing increasingly monstrous particle accelerators to slam together particles in an attempt to replicate the collisions that cosmic rays spark in the upper atmosphere. This quest has culminated with CERN's Large Hadron Collider, LHC, with a 16-mile, 26-kilometer circumference deep beneath the French-Swiss border. Yet despite its impressive size, power, and utility, the LHC still can't reach the energies produced by cosmic ray collisions. Another huge effort was made in order to build the famous Ice Cube Neutrino Detector, a neutrino detector built at a scientific installation under the Antarctic ice in the South Pole. Spherical geometry detectors are arranged in vertical wells of 60 modules each. The wells are built using a cone-shaped drill that sprays hot water. On Wikipedia, we can read, "The aim of the Ice Cube Neutrino project is the detection of high-energy neutrinos. Most of these neutrinos are generated by the interaction of cosmic rays with the nuclei of the Earth's atmosphere. But an unknown fraction of these could have astronomical origins. To distinguish the two sources, statistical analyses on the direction and angle of entry of neutrinos into ice are taken into consideration. Very roughly, it can be said that a neutrino coming from above is more likely to have been produced by the penetration of the shower of cosmic rays into the atmosphere, while those neutrinos that come from below, from the bottom of the sea, are more likely to have a different origin. It happens sometimes that scientists find something unexpected. Maybe they don't even know what to say in front of their new amazing discovery. so they give weird names to it. This was the case of the so-called Oh My God Particle. Oh My God Particle was a high-energy cosmic ray detected on October 15, 1991 by the University of Utah. The name derives from the stupor that it caused in the astrophysics community, because its energy was estimated to be around 3 times 10 to the power of 20 EV, the most energetic particle ever detected ever since that day. Using a criterion from comparison, it was like a baseball reaching a velocity of 94 kilometers per hour. That means it was traveling at almost the speed of light. Due to relativistic time dilation, at that speed the Oh My God Particle would travel to our nearest neighbor, star Proxima Centauri, in 0.43 milliseconds of the particle's own time. It could continue on to our galactic core by the time I've finished reading this sentence, from its own perspective. OMG was the nickname given to the first example of what are now known as ultra-high-energy cosmic rays. Since the Oh My God Particle was detected, at least 72 other similar particles, i.e. with an energy of more than 5.7 times 1019 EV, were detected, confirming the existence of a still-known generator of accelerating particles. Considering that the energy of the vast majority of the particles goes from 10 mega electron volts and 10 giga electron volts, the detection of these types of particles is a very rare event. At this point, we are finally ready to answer the last question. What types of messages do cosmic rays carry with them? What makes cosmic rays useful as messengers is that they carry the traces of their origins. By studying the frequency with which different particles occur, we are able to determine the relative abundance of elements within the universe. But another field of research in which we find cosmic rays useful as messengers is the one studying antimatter. Once we have detected a cosmic particle, we are able to determine its velocity, its trajectory, its radiation, its mass, and its energy, as well as whether the particle is matter or antimatter. For this purpose, scientists installed a useful instrument on the International Space Station that is called Alpha Magnetic Spectrometer, which is able to measure 50 million particles per day, with information about each particle being sent in real time from the space station to laboratories on Earth. This data contains useful information about antimatter that will enable us to understand more about it. So if you happen to look at the sky at night, you may see the ISS, where the Alpha Magnetic Spectrometer receives the tiny cute messengers that carry cosmic secrets. That's all for this video. Thanks for watching, everyone. What did you know about cosmic rays? Did you find this information useful? Were you amazed by the huge energy owned by the Oh My God Particle? Is there anything more you want to hear about life on other planets? Let me know in the comments below. Be sure to subscribe, and I'll see you next time on the channel.